Okay, so today I just wanted to, I just got a really quick look at the, rules of engagement. So today we're going to be, debating, out of love and out of just going to be on our Christians required or commanded to keep the laws of Moses. Okay, so the rules of engagement, rule number one, give honor and glory to God by is what we're going to conduct in ourselves in an orderly fashion. Please respect the position of moderator. I'll do my best in the sight of God to be fair to both parties, allowing each other to have enough time to answer each question accordingly. Rule number two is when one is speaking, please be respectful to the other party. And speak when it's your turn. Each section has time restrictions, so please, when your time is up, please stop. Okay. And number four, stay on topic. And the topic is, again, is required to keep the laws of Moses, or commanded to keep the laws of Moses. We're going to have 15 minutes of each opening statements, half hour each, and we're going to do one round of rebuttals, 10 minutes. And then we're going to have another round of rebuttals, 5 minutes. And then we're going to do two questions for each side, asking the opposing side their questions. And we will have 1 minute to answer those questions. And then we're going to have minutes of closing statements. You guys ready? Does that sound right?
Yes.
Yeah. Amen.
All right. So... Victor or
the one that has the
first. Okay.
You wanna hold it? Wanna hold this?
Can we hold this for me?
Yeah.
We hold that for
Andy,
me.
Andy, can you put your name and your position so people would know at all times?
Like, should I stand?
Yeah.
Is it that one?
Just for clarity.
It's on YouTube. I think.
Brother Victor, you would think your position is to keep the laws of Moses as a Christian required or commanded.
Can we make it one clear thing? Laws of God. I'm for the laws of God. G-O-D.
Okay.
I'm not giving any man any respect. It is laws of God. It is not from man. It is from God. So laws, period. That's what I stand for. Yes.
And that would include the laws of Moses?
The Levitical law, the Mount Sinai, the Ten Commandments, yes, the Torah. The Ten Commandments, Leviticus, Deuteronomy, Exodus, all that stuff.
Okay.
Yes. Law of God.
Okay. And Andy, your position is not commanded to keep the laws of Moses as a Christian?
That's my position, yeah.
Okay. All right, so Brother Victor, you have 15 minutes.
Yes.
All right, so Brother Victor?
Yes.
Are you ready?
Yes, indeed I am.
Okay, 15 minutes starts now.
Yes. Father God, I just want to say thank you for your mercy, your kindness. I call upon your presence. I call upon your wisdom. I call upon your spirit, Lord God, to educate all of us, for God, into righteousness and in truth, for God, that we'll grow in righteousness, grow in adoration and love and faithfulness to you, Lord God. Let this not be a battle over who's right, because only one is right, that is God. And so, Father God, we just come here, Lord God, as the Queen of Sheba came from a distant land to hear the wisdom of Solomon, we come, God, into this place, for God, in Manhattan, New York, Lord God, to hear the wisdom of Jesus Christ through his spirit, the spirit of truth. And so I just ask you to give us discernment, Lord God. Where's light and where's dark, Lord God, and let it be separated. Where's truth and where's fiction, let it be separated, Lord God. And put a distinction, Lord God, your commandments versus the contrary. So I just ask you, in the name of Jesus Christ, please endow us with your knowledge and lead this discussion, Lord God, so we can increase in love and peace and mercy and wisdom, because wisdom is first peaceable, and it's pure, and it's holy, and it's righteous, and it's more precious than gold and silver. And we're asking for wisdom, knowledge, understanding, courage, faith, love, and be the Holy Spirit in all things. In Jesus' name I declare it. Amen. My name is Victor Young Savage. I support the law of God for Christians. And A Christian is one, first, who believes in Jesus. That's a Christian. A person that testifies to Christ, that's a Christian. And so the question is, do people that confess Jesus as Lord, should they keep the commandments of God? G-O-D, okay? It's not a man gave us these laws, it's God himself gave us this law, these laws. It's his own finger that wrote on the tablets of stone the laws, the Ten Commandments, twice. It's out of his own mouth, God, out of God's mouth, that spoke the commandments. All of them. He spoke them. Okay? So I say this. What are the laws? What are the laws? Laws of God. G-O-D. This is what the Old Testament says in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4 and 5. This is Old Testament. This is the law. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, soul with all thy might. Here's another law of the Old Testament. Leviticus 19, verse 18. Thou shalt not avenge nor bear any grudge against the children of thy people, but thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. I am the Lord. New Testament teaching, this is Jesus speaking. Mark chapter 12, verse 28 through 31, you'll hear Jesus speaking. New Testament. And one of the scribes came, and having heard them reasoning together, and perceiving that he had answered them well, asked, which is the first commandment of God? Which is the first commandment of all? And Jesus answered him, first of all, the commandments is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, with thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment. And the second, namely this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. There's none other commandment greater than these. It's Mark chapter 12, verse 28 through 31. Jesus himself is telling you, which are the commandments of God? Okay? So you guys are saying, well, you know, I love Jesus. Okay, so Jesus says this. If John 14, verse 15. Jesus says, if you love me, keep my commandments. And then we go into what? Okay, well, we got to find out what the commandments of God are. And so Jesus quotes verbatim the Old Testament. What Jesus testifies is what was already prophesied 1,200 years prior. Okay, so Jesus never contradicts the law of God. In fact, he says, I did not come to abolish the law of the prophets, but to fulfill. Okay, and I'll get into that a little bit later. So, if a Christian says, I love Jesus Christ, there's a second step to that. You can't just praise him on your lips and your heart be far from him. You have to praise him with your lips and your heart must be one with him. And he says, this is it. If you love me, then obey my commandments. Okay. And there's no confusion what commandments we're talking about. No confusion anymore. Because the Old Testament and the New Testament, they're one. One God, my friends. So, my personal note. What's the reason Victory on Sin keeps the commandments of God? Let's reference Revelation 14, 12. Here's the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus Christ. What does that mean? There's two things in Christianity. Faith in Jesus Christ, which all Christians profess, but Christians keep the commandments of God. That's the distinction. Even devils, they know that there's a God and they tremble. But that doesn't make them obedient or saved. Am I right? Yes. These Muslims, they say that they have God. They know that there's a single God. Do they obey them? Absolutely. No. Do they obey God? No, they don't. Because their God is a liar, a deceiver. His name is Satan, Lucifer. That's who's enthroned in Islam. Do they believe in God? Just like the devils. The distinction is this. Who obeys God and who disobeys God? Both believe. Everybody in hell is a believer. There's not a single atheist in hell. They all know who put them there, the power of God. And they know why they went in there, because of deception and lawlessness. Another reference to Revelation. And the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Two things, my friends. Two things. That's Revelation 12, 17. Another personal note. My testimony. What is victory unto them? Keep the command of God and teach them. Matthew 5, 17, 19. Jesus, think not that I come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law, till all be fulfilled. Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men so, shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. Whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be in the kingdom of heaven. These are eternal riches, eternal glory, are both the least and the yes, they're in Jerusalem. Are the glory and the rewards different? Yes, and now we know why. Thing for you. Maybe some of you don't know, maybe like, you know, you guys don't know. The Old Testament is divided into three parts. The Torah, which are the first five books of the Bible, which is also known as the Law. The second is categorized as the Prophets. And then the Ketuvim, which is the Writings. This is given to man by God. The Talmud is a collection of writings that covers Jewish law and tradition as taught and expounded by various rabbis from over 600 years. Not given by God, but by man, and has false testimony about Jesus Christ and the elucidated laws of God and false laws of God. I stand on this principle, and this is eternal principle that most people can go by, and ask yourself, what would Jesus do? Ask yourself, what would you do? You could find out. Was Jesus circumcised on the eighth day? Yes, Jesus was circumcised on the eighth day. Do you want to be like Jesus? Yes, I want to be like Jesus. If he did this, would you want to? Yes, because I want to be like Jesus. A facsimile, a perfection, a mirror image of Jesus. Another thing, did Jesus obey the Sabbath? What would Jesus do? Did he keep the Sabbath holy? Yes, Jesus kept the Sabbath holy. He obeyed all the commandments of God. If you want to be like Jesus, should you keep the commandments of God and keep the Sabbath holy? Yes. Why? Because Jesus did it and I want to also. Did Jesus eat unclean food? No, Jesus did not eat unclean food. Why? Because the law says don't eat unclean food. Hey, do you want to not eat unclean food? No, I don't. Why? Because Jesus did not eat unclean food. Okay, pretty simple. It's written, the testimony of Jesus Christ is written. He'll tell you what he did and didn't do. That should be your navigator. That should be your compass. What would Jesus do? Okay, period. I stand on those precepts. This is a blessing from God, given to the high priest, to Aaron. And this is what God said. This is found in Numbers chapter 6, verse 22 through 27. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto his sons, saying, on this wise ye shall bless the children of Israel, saying unto them, the Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face shine upon thee and interest unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. And they shall put my name upon the children of Israel, and I will bless them. My God is one. One law, one God. In Jesus' name. So, Father God, I just want to say thank you for this awesome time to stand in your righteousness, in your holiness, in your purity, to speak truth, Lord God, with boldness and assurance, God, that you are holding me up, Lord God. I'm not holding you up, but you're holding me up, Lord God. Truth and wisdom and righteousness in your righteousness, Lord God. I'm redeemed by your blood that was shed for me, Lord God. But the new covenant, not through the blood of with Abraham, not like the covenant, Lord God, with Moses through the blood of animals, but the blood of the Lamb of God, the Son of God, Jesus Christ, the Son of God. That's the new covenant. Not through animals, but through Jesus, God's Son. That's the covenant I profess. That's the covenant of Israel. So I bless the King of the Jews. The King of the Jews, I bless you in name. I bless Abraham, I bless Israel. Father God, be blessed and glorified and exalted in everything that you do. I'm here asking for salvation and truth, Lord God. to disseminate truth for God, purity and holiness for God, to be called among the great in the kingdom of God, now and forever in Jesus' name, I pray, amen. That's my confession.
Amen.
You have 3.5 minutes. You can see.
I can glorify God. I can glorify God. I just want to say thank you, my friends, for coming here to listen to this. I pray that you open up your ears to truth. To truth. Just say, God, open my ears to truth and give me discernment, Lord God, to know the truth and to hold on to that. To hearken and to hold on to wisdom and despise foolishness. Give me the your precepts. They are my light for my feet. Your words, O God, eternal and true. Your testimonies, faithful and true. So, Father, I just ask you to unify us in spirit and in truth, because the judgment will come. And so I'm here, Lord God, before you, my judge and my advocate. Also, you are my propitiation for my sins and my iniquity. I don't confess my righteousness. It is a dirty rag. And so I call upon you for your shed blood to wash away my sins, my iniquity, Lord God, for the transgression of my soul against you and your holy law. And I glorify you in Jesus' name. And I thank you for your word that is salvation to all nations. You have elected, you have selected Abraham to be a blessing for all nations. You have selected Israel to be a blessing for all nations. And we serve only one God, that is the God of Israel. And I bless you and glorify you and honor you and love you with all our soul, mind, and strength, and obey you in Jesus' name. I'm going to give you one reference. This is John 3:4. Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law. For sin is the transgression of the law. Sin is lawlessness. It is a transgression of what law are we talking about? The same law from the very beginning. I rise. Be at peace in Jesus' name.
What
happens?
You good?
I'm good.
Andy, you have 15 minutes starting now.
Thank you for being here. This is very important topic to talk about, even though whether Christians are commanded, to keep the law of Moses, which is the law of God, yes. But in scripture, it's termed as the law of Moses because, it was Moses. He was like the mediator, to give it to the children of Israel, as he was the only one that was on Mount Sinai. No one else was on Mount Sinai. And it is imperative. Basically, a bit strange that we're still here in 2019 and we're still talking about something that was basically dealt with even in scripture. It was actually the very early church. They had a dilemma on what to do with Gentiles that are turning to God. What do we do? And as we all know, those of us who know our Bible, the council met up in Jerusalem that were comprised of the elders and the actual apostles, and this discussion was talked about. And I'm not right now. It's in my first 15 minutes. I'm not going to respond, even though I may respond to this, but this is not my actual rebuttal time. This is my opening statement. So I'm just going to declare what I stand on, and just as says, and I don't doubt that he stands on Jesus. We all stand on Christ, is why we're all here today. But there is a very distinction to be made, because in the scriptures there were those who were Pharisees, as we know who the Pharisees were. There were Pharisees who believed in Jesus. They asked Jesus Christ as the Messiah, the Son of God. And it's right in scripture in Acts chapter 15, verse 5, there was a sect of Pharisees who believed. So they were not unbelievers, and I know that there is not an unbeliever, but the problem here is that the Pharisees who believed, they held to the law of Moses, and they were saying to the people that unless the Gentiles that are turning to God, unless they get circumcised, keep the law of Moses, which I know Victor also stands on, says they cannot be saved. So this is one of the most important topics we can talk about, even though that earlier, the scriptures already dealt with this. It's not taking just the Old Testament, and parts. You have to take all of scripture, all of sola scriptura. So the first passage that I would like to go to in order to establish my case here would be Colossians chapter 2, the very first passage. And Colossians chapter 2 have the writing from the Apostle Paul to the Colossians. And this was not only a problem in the church in Colossae, but in other churches, as we see very plainly, like in the book of Ephesians, which I probably would get into. Sorry. But in Colossians chapter 2, verse 16, and I'm going to begin just in case anybody says that I'm not reading something in context. Starting from verse 11, it says, In him, speaking to Jesus, you were also circumcised with the circumcision made without hands. Very important. A circumcision made without hands, by putting off the body of the flesh, by the circumcision of Christ, buried with him in baptism, in which you also were raised with him through faith in the working of God who raised him from the dead. And you being dead in your trespasses and circumcision of your flesh, he has made alive together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, having wiped out the handwriting of that was against us, which was contrary to us, and he has taken it away, having nailed it to the cross, having disarmed principalities and powers, and he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. Here's the two key verses. So let no one judge you in food or in drink or regarding a festival or a new moon or Sabbath, which are a shadow of things to come, but the substance is of Christ. So Paul is basically writing to the church in Colossae and saying, this liberty that we have in Christ, if you're eating, foods that were considered unclean, or keeping feasts, which were part of the law, and new moon and Sabbaths, which was also part of the law, Paul is saying these were a shadow of things to, therefore, to let no one judge you in what you eat or in what feasts you keep, or you keep Sabbath days or days, because these are only shadows. See, I want the real thing. I want the real thing, not a shadow. And that the real thing is Christ. Jesus is the substance. The substance is Christ. So he was addressing the other part that I will mention as well, is in the Acts, which is because I could go on, but since I'm very limited in time, in the book of Acts, chapter 15 mainly. It's a very important passage, and it speaks about directly what we're debating today. Whether Christians, now that we live in the new covenant, should we go and live under the old covenant? And the law of Moses, that law that was given by God, it came from God. It didn't come from Moses. It came from God, but that was the former covenant. We all know, split the Bible that way. Old covenant, new covenant. Acts chapter 15 tells us very plainly, and I'll begin from the first verse, which says, certain men came down from Judea and taught the brothers in Christ, unless you are circumcised according to the custom of Moses, And just to stop right there, what is the custom of Moses? That's another way of saying the law of Moses. The custom of Moses, the law that God gave to Moses. It says, unless you are circumcised according to the custom of Moses, you cannot be saved. This is the issue that we're debating here today. And my opponent can correct me if I'm wrong, but I've heard his position many times now, that Christians ought to keep the law of Moses. Even though he does believe in the sacrifice of Christ, which is obviously a actual necessity, but Christ came not so that we got to the law of Moses. But just to continue here, therefore, said when Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and with them, they determined that Paul and Barnabas and certain others of them should go up to Jerusalem, apostles and elders, about this question. So being sent on their way by the church, they passed through Phoenicia, Samaria, describing the conversion of the Gentiles, and they caused great joy to all the brethren. And when they had come to Jerusalem, they were received by the church and the apostles and elders, and they reported all things that God had done with them. Now, so again, like I pointed earlier, I know Victor is someone who believes in Christ, but unfortunately, he has the same position that the actual Pharisees that believed had. It's the same position. And it says here, but some of the sect of the Pharisees who believed rose up, saying it is necessary to circumcise them and to command them to keep the law of Moses. So, issue here, then it would be no problem. If that was the case, then we just have to keep the law of Moses. No question asked. We know it's the law of God, but why is a distinction being made? Why is even this council coming up and talking about this problem? And if you read the rest of, I'm not going to read the whole chapter of chapter 15, but I'm going to read the actual conclusion that they came up with. The conclusion is from verse 22, says, then it pleased the apostles and elders with the whole church to send chosen men of their own company to Antioch with all of us, namely Judas, who was also named Barsabbas, and Silas, leading men and brethren. They wrote this letter by them, the apostles and elders and the brethren, to the brethren who are of the Gentiles in Antioch, Syria, and Cilicia, greetings. Since I heard that some who went out from us have troubled you with words, unsettling your soul, saying you must be circumcised to keep the law to whom we gave no such commandments. It seemed good to us, being assembled with one accord, to send children to you with our beloved Barnabas and Paul, men who have risked lives for the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We have therefore sent Judas and Silas, who will also report the same things by word of mouth. For it seemed good to the Spirit, this is very key, it seemed good to God. You know the Holy Spirit is God. It seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us to lay upon you no greater burden than these necessary things. Abstain from things offered to idols, from blood, from things strangled, and from sexual immorality. If you keep yourself from these, you will do well. And I think this is like the basically very early on the nail in the casket, because this is what the apostles' conclusion came with. Now, my opponent Victor says, we don't follow Paul, we don't follow Christ. Well, yeah, we follow Christ, but wasn't it the Apostle Paul who was ordained by Christ to be an apostle and a minister, that he was the one that said to the churches, being inspired by the Holy Spirit? So it didn't come from himself. It came, from the Spirit of God himself, that, Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. So it's not a sin or thing to follow someone who's following Christ. Because you are following Christ, but this is just the actual substance here, because the very question, are we commanded to keep the law of Moses? And that is exactly what we're debating today. And the scriptures are explicitly clear that no, we are not commanded to keep the law of Moses. And mind you, the law of Moses is the former covenant. We're not in our former covenant. Passage that I would like to point to, very key here, is in Romans chapter 14. It talks about liberty that we have when it comes to surveys that we keep and even foods that we eat.
1 minute and a half.
Okay, so I don't have much time, but basically, if Romans chapter 14, which I could probably get into later, the Apostle Paul wrote to the church in Rome, and he is telling us that we also should not judge those who eat, and that those who eat should not judge those who do eat, because God is able to make them stand. And so he applies the same principle with actual days that we keep. So one person esteems one day above another, another esteems this every day alike. Let each be fully convinced in his own mind. He who observes a day observes it to the Lord, and he who does not observe the day to the Lord, he does not observe it. He who eats, eats to the Lord, for he gives God thanks. And he who does not eat to the Lord, he does not eat and gives God thanks. So what is the principle here? It's faith. In new covenant, if you consider something to be unclean, to you it is unclean. To you. If you have faith to eat, you give thanks to God, and as it says in elsewhere, it's sanctified by prayer. So that's it.
All right, so we're going to do 1 of 10 minute rebuttals. Victor, when you're ready, time will start.
Yes. God, thank you once again, Lord God, for giving us the ability to hear, Lord God, to hear your wisdom, to hear your love, your law, your commandments, Lord God. We're here to be taught by you and none else, Lord God. The Spirit of Truth, once again, come here, Lord God, and to wisdom, knowledge, and instruction, Lord God, to be holy, for you are holy. Your laws, your commandments are holy, your word is holy, your word became flesh in Jesus' name. So, Father God, I just ask you to unify us, for God, in spirit and in truth, for God, in wisdom, without a doubt, with wisdom, conviction, that we choose truth, we choose life, we choose blessing, we choose Christ today. Father God, lead my thought and my heart and my word, God, to hallow your name and to glorify you, to honor you, and to bless you, that your wisdom come from my lips and none other. In Jesus' name, amen. So, my friends, let's reference Acts chapter to the chapter 15 of Acts. And so, this is the very first verse in Acts chapter 15, and you really need to look at a very specific word, and it's at the end of that verse, and I'm going to read it for you. Acts chapter 15, verse 1, King James Version. Certain men which came down from Judea taught the brethren and said, except ye be circumcised after the manner of Moses, ye cannot be saved. What's the argument there? What's that? You have to do this to be saved. And God said, no, you don't. You have to believe in Jesus Christ to be saved. If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe that God, with his power, raised him up from the dead, you shall be saved. Okay? These men from Judea said, you guys, the only way you can be saved, you got to get a bris. You got to get circumcised. That's the only way you can be. So the question is salvation. The question is salvation. How do we get saved? I just told you. It's written in the Bible. Confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord, and with your heart believe that God raised him from the dead, and you shall be saved. Okay? That's salvation. This entire chapter goes on the topic of salvation. We'll go and reference chapter 15 of Acts, verse 5. But there rose up certain of the sect of the Pharisees, which believed, saying that it was needful to circumcise them and to command them to keep the law of Moses. Is this still the topic of salvation? That's the question. That's the question.
No.
What are these people from the Pharisees believe? Do they believe in their own righteousness and their own works? Believe in.
Sorry. Thank you.
Do they believe? Look at. You know, I did my due. I respect. It's your turn. You know, newbie. That's kind of what the Pharisees were. And they wanted to put yokes on them that they couldn't even bear themselves. Jesus many times refuted with them, argued with them, rebuked them harshly, and even judged them. Because they could not fulfill the laws, but they commanded other people to fulfill, to do this. But they were hypocrites. They were hypocrites. And Jesus does not tell us that. He said, take my yoke, it's light, my burden is easy. Okay? So, the Pharisees are telling you, you got to do this, you got to do that, you got to do this. And putting like, but that's not how salvation comes from. Salvation doesn't come through work, it comes through faith in Jesus Christ. Okay, so this is the next section of Acts chapter 15, verse 11. For we believe that the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, we shall be saved as they. So the question is this. The Jews had all of Moses for 1,200 years before Jesus was born. Before that, he said, the only way to be saved, the only way to have grace with God is to obey the commandments of God, which is saved by Moses and Joshua and all of history. Obey, and God won't judge you. Okay? And so that still remains. But salvation, actual salvation, comes through faith in Jesus Christ under the new covenant. In the beginning, God gave Adam and Eve one commandment, one law, don't eat. Sounds like a Levitical law, doesn't it? Sounds a dietary law. Don't eat. And you guys think that not eating or not eating is like fictitious or unimportant. Ask Adam and Eve, hey, that dietary law, was that important? Yeah, Adam and Eve didn't say, it's pretty important. Okay, so the law of God remains. Okay, so this is pertaining to salvation. Salvation, we cannot earn our salvation. They tried for 1,200 years. They cannot earn salvation. They had to believe. They had to believe in God for his mercy, for his righteousness, for his, they're looking for Messiah to get them out of the pits of hell because they couldn't get out themselves. Okay, so they needed a savior. They're looking for Messiah since the very beginning. Moses even prophesied about Jesus Christ. God will raise up a brother out of your midst. You listen to him. He'll bring you salvation. Okay? Moses couldn't bring them salvation. He couldn't even bring his own salvation. He didn't even walk on that land while he was alive. So salvation didn't come through acts, but through faith, as it still is today. So after the transgression during Noah's time, God gave seven more commandments. We started with one, with Adam and Eve. Then there's the Noahide laws that many Jews, Pharisees, believe that they only want the Gentiles to follow the seven commandments. You don't have to follow the other 613. That's only for the Jews, as you believe. And they believe the same thing because you guys want to be ostracized from the Jewish Messiah. And so they do too. And you guys stand in that conviction, polarization, which I'm against. So there's the seven Noahide laws. God said, okay, look at, you guys need more rules. Rules are safety guards. These rules weren't there because you didn't make these transgressions and now you're lost. You didn't even know why. Well, because you went off the path, the beaten path, and this is how you did it. You did this, this, and this, which is against the law. I did not permit you to do that. That's why you're like this, okay? That's with Noahide, covenant, the rainbow. So, the righteousness of Abraham came through believing. He believed God, and that counted him for righteousness. If you don't believe God, you're not going to obey him. Okay? And you can't please God if you don't believe him. So faith comes first, then comes obedience. As long as you're touching Christ, you'll be a part of him. Am I right? If you don't touch him, you're not going to be a part of him. So you first, the connection is faith. To connect to Christ, you have to believe in Christ. Okay, that's the first step. That's how you please God. Obedience is your part now. Obedience is, okay, are you going to hearken to his voice? Because, you know, they connected with God. They saw the pillar of fire. They saw the cloud. They saw the glory of God. All of Israel saw Mount Sinai. But did they obey? They had faith. God is right there. God is right there. But did they obey him? And that's the second part, my friends. That's the second part. And it says, obey my commandments, obey my commandments, obey my commandments. Always. God never changes. Like I said, the devils believe there's a God and they tremble. That doesn't save them. And it doesn't make them obedient. Atheists or whatever, they believe there's a God. Muslims believe in a God, but they don't obey him. So there's a two-step process, my friends. Okay, now that we're connected, now that we're friends, are you gonna do what I want you to do? Are you going to be obedient to me? Are you going to be my bride and obedient to me, the groom? Or are you going to be a reckless whore? Because your recklessness and your whoredom will distance you from me. That's your actions. Faith is connected to Christ. Obedience is remaining connected. Cool? So Acts is talking about salvation. Salvation only comes by faith in Christ. One law, one commandment, faith in Christ. Period. Is that my time?
No, you still have 1 minute.
Oh, God. Okay, thank you. So we went from one law with Adam and Eve. We went to 7 with Noah. We went to 613 with Moses. Jesus gave us one commandment. Love. Through him. Through Jesus. Believe in Jesus Christ and you shall be saved. One law. Believe in Jesus. That's it. Jesus brought us back to one commandment. Jesus is Lord. That's it. That's it. We're back to one law. Jesus. Glory to God. Thank you, Father. I love you. Jesus. Glory to God, Father God. I just want to say, Lord God, with every moment that I have on life, and for every breath, Lord God, let it glorify you, honor you, worship you, and bless you, Lord God. I love you with all my heart, soul, and strength, and obey you in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 All right, so just a disclaimer really quick. For those that have joined a little bit later, we're going to hold all questions and comments until afterwards. We're just for time restraints, but we do have time allocated for that. And I'm just going to switch timers because it's actually battery's getting ready to... and whenever you're ready, Brother Andy. And it's time.
Okay. Going back to Acts chapter 15, yes, it is about salvation, but that's exactly what we're addressing here, because if we're commanded to keep the law of Moses, the former covenant, that's not the new covenant, then we are talking about salvation here. Because if the position that Victor has is that after we believe on Christ, that we should keep the law of Moses, and if we don't keep the law of Moses, then we're sinning against God. And obviously we know that sin and God does not go together. Sin is what separates us from God. So if it's his position that we're sinning against God after we have believed by not keeping the law of Moses, which includes circumcision, which includes the Sabbath day, which includes all the actual dietary laws, then salvation is the topic that we're talking about. And so it is rightly to address Acts chapter 15, and it's relevant to what we're speaking of. Because again, even though I know that you believe that we're saved by grace, which obviously that's the case, but the Pharisees here, they also believed on Christ. They knew that they had to believe, because if they have to believe in Christ, then if their position was, well, you know, I don't have to believe in Christ to be saved, then this issue will not even come up. But they believe in Christ because they already understood that salvation comes through Christ unless they would not believe, just like the other unbelieving Jews. So it says specifically that the sect of the Pharisees that believed commanded the brethren that unless the Gentiles that are turning to God, unless they get circumcised and keep the law of Moses, they can't be saved. The question is not whether they can be saved through Jesus, because they believed in Jesus, so they knew that they had to be saved through Jesus. But the problem was that they didn't understand how to transition from the former covenant to the new covenant. They thought that the new covenant had to involve the former covenant. So they brought the old covenant into the new covenant, and that cannot happen because the new covenant is something totally different. As Jeremiah 31 says, you know, that I'm going to make a new covenant with the house of Jacob and the house of Israel, and it shall not be like the covenant that I made with your fathers on Mount Sinai. So there is a big difference here. The new covenant is Jesus Christ himself. As Colossians 2 said, that he is the substance. He is the actual fulfillment of what was written. Now, since this is my first rebuttal time, I'm going to go through as many of the passages that he brought up before. He brought up John chapter 14. John chapter 14, Jesus says in John chapter 14, verse 15, he says that, if you love me, keep my commandments. Now, right when he said that, Victor said, if you notice, he said, you know, that Jesus quoted an Old Testament passage here. Well, there is no Old Testament passage in this part of the scripture that Jesus is talking about. He said, if you love me, keep my commandments. There is no reference to a Old Testament passage. He goes on to explain about the Holy Spirit here. So if I don't know if and he could correct me if I'm wrong, but he did say that he was referring an Old Testament passage here, but there is no quotation from the Old Testament in this context here. So maybe he can elaborate on that afterwards. But if you love me, keep my commandments. What commandments was Jesus speaking of? Was he speaking of the Sabbath? Was he speaking of the dietary laws? Was he speaking about the unclean foods and things like that? What was he speaking of? Now remember, it's John writing this gospel. And he's the same one that wrote the book Revelation as well, where Victor also quoted from Revelation chapter 14, 12 and verse 17, where it says that this is the test and the patience of the saints, those who keep the commandments of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. That's Revelation chapter 14, verse 12. John would not be contradicting himself, and he hasn't brought it up, but I will go there. First John as well. John the Apostle records and talks about keeping the commandments of God. For example, in First John chapter 2. First John chapter 2. John says, "By this we know that we know him, if we keep his commandments. He who says I know him and does not keep his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him." Well, that is true. So, but if you keep reading, what commandments is John speaking about? Because obviously, if we're obviously First John, it is referencing about the commandments of Jesus, and he says, and he continues to say, but whoever keeps his word, the commandments that we're to keep is the words of Jesus. Now, Jesus said many things, and he said many things that were not in the former covenant. The former covenant didn't have the law, for example, where it says, love your enemy. It does say love your neighbor. It does say that. But we know that in the, Jesus even quoted it in the very same in the same chapter that Victor was referencing, in Matthew chapter 5 as well, where he said, you know, an eye and a tooth for a tooth. That's the former covenant. But now in the new covenant, Jesus lays out these new words, these new commandments given to us, and he brings those commandments, as he said, Victor also quoted this, I have not come to destroy the law. Yes, he came to fulfill it. Now, who is the one that fulfills it? Who's the one that came to bring it to fulfillment? Is it Jesus or is it us? It was Jesus. He's the one that brings it to fulfillment. He brings it to its ultimate meaning. That is why we don't sacrifice no more, because Jesus is the fulfillment of that sacrifice. And so it is. We have to understand that John is not going to be speaking two different things from his mouth. In John chapter 14, when he records Jesus saying, "If you love me, keep my commandments," it is speaking of his word, the words that Jesus spoke to his disciples during his ministry. And we know that because in 1 John, the same author, right after he says, "If by this we know that we know him, if we keep his commandments," which is obviously in parallel to Jesus in John chapter 14, 15. And when we keep reading, obviously in verse 5, it said, "But whoever keeps his word is synonymous for commandment." When Jesus speaks his word unto us, he's giving us commandments. Like, example, when he says, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature." That's a commandment. That is his word. Another thing, in the original Greek here, the word for commandments is entelos. And you could look that up yourself. Every time it's speaking about the commandments of Jesus, the words of Jesus, the Greek word is being used, entelos. That is the commandment. Anytime the New Testament refers to the law of Moses, it's a totally different word. It doesn't use the commandments of Jesus. And so there's a distinction to be made here. And so we know that the commandments here are not talking about the Torah law.
Okay. All right, so next section is going to be a rebuttal, but we're going to do a 5-minute rebuttal from each side. Victor, let me know when you're ready.
Okey doke.
Ready?
Yeah.
Start.
Once again, Lord God, I just want your wisdom. I want your power, your strength, your love, your spirit to dwell here, Lord God, from my lips. Lord God, before I utter anything, Lord God, let it be not from my heart, my understanding, my mind, my perspective, or me whatsoever, but let it be from the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth, Lord God, because I don't want to bring anything of mine to the table because it is worthless, and I only want to bring the offering of that was given to us by God, which is the Son of God, the Lamb of God, that was slain before the foundation of the world, his truth, your truth, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, Lord God, and your law to teach wisdom, to endow us, and to increase in wisdom and righteousness and justice, Lord God, for the purification of our souls, Lord God, believing in Christ and walking in holiness and righteousness, Lord God. Whatever clarity that we need, Lord God, just open my lips, Lord God, to speak truth and to speak peacefully and lovingly with wisdom and compassion and understanding, to disperse knowledge pure, holy, and righteous from the mouth of God and no one else. So, Father God, please, Lord God, establish your goodness and everything that's required, Lord God, for us to come into a holy knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and the commandments of God and the words of God. In Jesus' name, I declare, amen. Okay. I actually have a question. Can you tell me your reference for the scripture of contrary to the so-called teaching against the laws of God? Can you reference that Bible verse that you brought up on your time? I didn't write it down.
The Bible verse that I was speaking.
Yeah, to refute me, yes.
The ones that you brought up, or the ones
yours personal.
Mm-hmm. Well, I was talking about 1 John chapter 2.
Okay.
Verses 3, 4, 5. I was just trying to touch on the ones that you quoted, so I didn't really bring anything new, even though I know you didn't bring this up, but I was trying to touch on the passages that you.
Okay, so 1 John chapter 2, verse 4, he that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. And the commandments are the same, as I'm going to reiterate one more time, Old Testament and New Testament, they're in unison. There's a new commandment, same God, same word of God, period. The covenant is this, that we believe in Christ, period. Okay? That's the new covenant. That it's not through the sacrifice of animals, as with Abraham, as with Moses, but the sacrifice of God. And the covenants are made by blood, my friends. And so is the blood of Jesus Christ. This is the new covenant. This is a new agreement. A covenant is a law. It's a contract between two parties, God and man. And the first covenant was, as you said, was with Abraham. And the second was with Moses. Now it's through Jesus Christ. Okay, so the commandments are the same. There's a new covenant and there's a new agreement saying that you'll have one commandment, you'll have one Messiah, that have a unity. Ezekiel's prophesied that there's going to be two branches, one for Ephraim, one for Judah, that they're going to be united. That's the new covenant that's prophesied where? In the Old Testament. To who? To Jews. Who are Jews? The people that obey God and the commandments of God. The Jews that were standing before Mount Sinai, that were judged for disobeying God, and that were blessed for obeying God. So we're talking to a nation, we're talking to a people that actually know and are very familiar with the laws of God, the commandments of God, understand that, well, we must keep that. But faith is first. Like I said before, faith is first, because if you do these commandments, you're working out your own righteousness. You're trying to work out your own righteousness, you're trying to work out your own strength, you're trying to do this without having faith in God, like I said before, that the devils believe in God, but they don't obey him. And so what changed was a new hope, a greater hope, a greater salvation, a new covenant through believing in the Messiah. And that's as far as I know. And if you don't keep the commandments, you're a liar. You can have faith in Jesus, but if you don't keep his commandments, you're a liar. That's all I'm going to say about 1 John chapter 2, verse 4. In Jesus' name.
Yep, 40 seconds.
40 seconds. Father God, I just want to say thank you for everything, Lord God, and I just ask you, Lord God, that you continue teaching us and listening your goodness and righteousness and your wisdom, Lord God. We're all here to learn, Lord God. We have one shepherd, we have one rabbi, we have one master. It's God alone. And so I just ask, Lord God, let not man's wisdom come here, Lord God, but let God's wisdom be here, Lord God. By your Spirit, Lord God, please educate all of us. In Jesus' name, amen.
So, and we've got 5 minutes from Brother Andy starting now.
Okay, just to point out just really quickly, the circumcision was given to Abraham. The circumcision, we all know circumcision, the Sabbath law, these were all, like the actual circumcision was before Mount Sinai, but it was incorporated into the law of Moses. The Sabbath, the seventh day rest, was given before the covenant on Mount Sinai, but incorporated to as a covenant to the children of Israel. Whenever we speak about the law of Moses, we're speaking about these very things. It's not separated; it's incorporated. If it is the case that when John says whoever does not keep his commandments is a lying truth, and if he was speaking about the actual 613 Torah laws, then how come Paul didn't make that make that actual statement as well? Because remember, obviously we know God doesn't contradict himself. They were inspired by the same spirit. And I tell you now, Paul did not promote the 613 laws to Gentiles. He did not contradict John. Remember, in the second chapter of Galatians, they gave John, Peter, and James, they gave Paul the right hand of fellowship, right? So that means they were in agreement. They were in agreement with these things. John, just to clear up this thing in 1 John, when John is speaking about the commandments of Jesus, he's not speaking about 613 Torah laws. And I'll tell you what, even the early church fathers, remember, we're not the first one that were given. There were people hundreds of years before us that were in the faith before us. They did not interpret it the way Victor does. Just really quickly, I would like to point out even a quote from Ignatius. Those of you who don't know Ignatius, he was the disciple of the Apostle John. And he wrote concerning the Sabbath day, which is part of the law of Moses. And he was writing to the Magnesians. And he said, if therefore those who were brought up in Asian, in the Asian order of things have come to possession of a new hope, no longer observing the Sabbath, but living in the observance of the Lord's day, on which also our life has sprung by him and by his death, whom some deny, by which mystery we have obtained faith and therefore endure, that we may be found the disciples of Jesus Christ, our only master. During the Sabbath, he continued under the earth in the tomb which Joseph of Arimathea had laid him. And the dawning of the Lord's day, he arose from the dead according to what was spoken by himself. As Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man also be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. The day of the preparation then comprises the passion. The Sabbath embraces the burial. The Lord's day contains the resurrection. And that part there was written to the Trillians. And there's many other quotes that I can quote from the early church fathers. And I'm quoting them because, especially Ignatius here, he's a disciple of the Apostle John. You couldn't get more closer, to the primary source than this. And they did not interpret it the way Victor does. And there's many others I can go to, but because of lack of time, but. First John is not speaking about 613 Torah laws. It's speaking about the words that Jesus brought during his ministry.
Okay, so thank you very much. God be glorified, be exalted, Lord God, and I just like your wisdom come.
That's the end of that's the end of that section. Okay. The next section that we're going to go to is where both sides are going to be able to question each other. They're going to say one question to the other. It's going to start with Victor questioning Andy, and Andy will have 1 minute to respond. And so, Victor, you have question.
My question is this dilemma. If there's one God, and there's one law, and there's one Messiah from that same God, if he's not talking about the law, you are saying that there's a different law that Jesus is talking about, which is not written in the New Testament. It may be scattered. It might be, okay, well, don't eat sacrifice to idols. Don't do this. Don't do this. Which actually states the original law from the very beginning, the Torah. And so, the law of Moses was repeated in Deuteronomy. So it was Leviticus and Deuteronomy. It's repetition of the law. And so, Jesus didn't come to repeat the law. They already knew the law for 1,200 years. He came to fulfill it because they knew what the law was. And so the question is this: what did Jesus use to fight off the temptation of Satan? The question is that. What did he use to fight off the temptation of Satan during the 40 days? Answer me that.
Yo, 1 minute.
Well, the answer is pretty clear. He used the word of God. He used actually Deuteronomy. He used Deuteronomy. And throughout his whole ministry, he quoted from the Old Testament because it is the Word of God.
Exactly.
But there is still a distinction to be made between the former covenant and the new covenant. Christians don't live under the old covenant. That's why you don't. Yeah, there you can keep feast days, you can keep a Sabbath day. That's great. But the problem is that a Christian who does not keep those things, they're not sinning against God because they're as Paul says in Romans 14, they don't observe it unto the Lord. So that's my answer.
Andy, you have a question for Victor, and Victor, you have 1 minute to answer.
Okay. I do want to go to where it's specifically stated here. And well, I got many questions, but you know, I'm going to ask one. I think. In Romans chapter 14, can you explain to me what Paul means when he says to the Romans that that if you don't observe the day to the Lord, you don't observe it, and if you observe the day unto the Lord, to the Lord, you do observe it. And then the same thing with foods. He said, you know, to those that eat, meaning those that eat basically anything by faith, to not despise those who do not eat, and that those who do not eat to not judge those who do eat. Can you explain to me what Paul is referencing there, as far as you know, the foods and the days that were being observed?
1 minute starts now.
Okay, Father God, thank you for everything. Speak for me. On my behalf, in Jesus' name. So this is it. Eateth not meat. Okay, so we're talking about meat. It doesn't say, oh, like pork. You know, it doesn't say, okay, we're gonna eat like crawfish. It said meat. So it's talking about food. Apostle Paul cannot contradict the law if he's a follower of Christ. Period. What law? There's only one law in the Bible. It's the Levitical law. It's the Deuteronomy. It's the Torah. You cannot be a disciple of Christ and teach contrary to God's law. If you do, you'll be considered the least in the kingdom of God, period. When it comes to concerning days and Sabbaths, maybe it was a conflict with cultures and things like that. I don't know what they were talking about, but I can tell you what God said perfectly. He said, if you don't, like the sons of Israel must present themselves three times before the Lord, three times a year. And if they don't, they'll be ostracized. They'll be cast out from the thing. That's what God says about following times and seasons and celebrations. Three times that the sons of Israel must present themselves.
All right, so one more round of questions. We'll start with Victor.
Questions? Yes. Okay. I want to just go over this one more time. This is verbatim. I'm just reading the book. Think not that I come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. Whosoever there shall break one of the least of these commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. Whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. Refute that. What is your pursuit? Least or great?
Sorry. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 17, and the rest of the verse that you just quoted there, Jesus is the one who fulfills the law and the prophets. Of course, he didn't come to abolish it, and that's why he used it to fight off the temptation, right? It was not fulfilled by us, it was fulfilled by him. And through him and through the giving of his spirit, now we also fulfill the law. But again, the distinction still has to be made, because the New Testament still makes the distinction that you're not making. And so you're conflating the actual commandments with the 613 Torah commandments, and then the New Testament makes those distinctions that you don't make.
Correct. Time. All right, so that ends the question and answer section of the debate, and we're going to finish with closing statements from each side, both 10 minutes. Victor, time starts now.
Thank you, Father. First, I glorify you, honor you, bless you, Lord God, because it is your plan of salvation. It is your Son that paid the price for me, Lord God. And I worship and adore you and worship and obey only you, your commandments, your word that are eternal, Lord God. From generation to generation, from everlasting to everlasting, your word remains the same, God. You never change. You cannot conflict your own word. You are one, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Your word is one. Your Israel, the Lord of God, is one Lord. And so, Father God, everybody that goes against the commandments of God, let them be educated, or let them understand what they're doing, but let them fear you, because you are worthy to be feared as well and as obeyed. So I just want to say bless you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. For teaching me the fear of the Lord and keeping the commandments of God. My friends, I just want to say that I stand on one thing. Look it, you're either going to teach and do them, or you're going to break them and teach to break them. And you're going to be one or the other. You're going to be, you can even choose greatness, or you can be the least in the kingdom of God. You'll get salvation. It's not even a question about salvation. It's about your riches and your reward in heaven, which Apostle Paul did care about too. He said, I became a servant to all. So my rewards, my riches would be greater. Apostle Paul talked about that. And so my question is this, my friends. We have Jesus Christ. We have the faith in Jesus Christ, his righteousness, his justice. But the second part is, do we also obey his commandments? Do we bend our neck to his yoke? Do we say, you know what, you're right, I don't, because you don't eat pork. Jesus never ate pork. If he ate pork, he would have went to the cross for his own sin. That's the truth. If he was circumcised on the eighth day, he would go to the cross for himself. He wouldn't go for you and me. He would go for himself, because he broke the commandments of God. So I tell you this, your choice is today. You have Jesus Christ. What do you want to do with Jesus Christ? You want to be great, or you want to be the least? Your choice. It really is your choice. Moses also put a choice before all of Israel, millions of people. He said, to this day you choose, Israel. Before you, I put as heaven and earth, I charge you. I stand here before you, before heaven. This is before heaven. I'm speaking to you. You have a choice: life and blessing, or death and cursing. That was to Israel. Look at all of Israel left Egypt, but he gave them a choice. What do you guys want? You guys want life and blessing, or you want death and cursing? And he told them, if you want life and blessing, obey God. Choose life. Choose blessing. Joshua said the same thing. I don't know if you guys consider it evil to serve God, but as for me and my house, we shall serve the Lord. You make a choice, my friends. God gives you a choice. God is a bad option. God is pro-choice. Pro-choice. Unfortunately, these people for abortion, they have chosen death. Just let you know, that's a choice. I choose life, I choose greatness, because Jesus right here in Mark 12 says, in Matthew 5:17, he gives you a choice. You're going to be in the kingdom of God. You're going to be in the kingdom of heaven. But are you going to be the least, or are you going to be the greatest? He's giving you the recipe for both. He's not keeping anything hidden from you. I want to be the greatest in the kingdom of God. That's why I pursue this. There's other ways of also being considered the greatest in the kingdom of God. He brought up a child. He said, you know, if you humble yourself as this child and walk in the faith, you know, if you're a servant, then you'll be considered the greatest in the kingdom of God. And also this, God tells you, look, there's real rewards, real riches, real everything. But to those who overcome, the book of Revelation says that you must do this to get the reward. You must overcome. You must keep the faith. You must keep the faith, and the faith is that Jesus is righteous, and he's leading you on paths of righteousness, or you'll fall into sin, which is any break of the law, any, even the least. Jesus said, even the least of these commandments, if you break it, you're in sin, you're in transgression against God's holy law. And so before you, I present to you the same thing as Moses presented to Israel, as Joshua presented to Israel. I'm presenting you what Jesus presented to you, least or greatest in the kingdom of God, period. In Jesus' name, amen.
To have 6 minutes.
Wow. Father God, what else can I, how else can I glorify you, to honor you, to bless you, to just reveal your goodness and your righteousness? To recap on Andy, so if you love me, keep my commandments. That is found in John 14:15. Jesus spoke my commandments. And what are his commandments? It's a reference back to, actually, Mark 12, verse 20-31. Jesus gave you the commandments already. The commandments are not this thing out of nowhere. They had the commandments for 1,200 years, and Jesus with his own lips said, these are the commandments of God. Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. These are the commandments of God that are directly, verbatim, explained from the Old Testament. In Deuteronomy and Leviticus,
In that one section of Mark, in the same chapter, Jesus speaks the commandments of God as directed, as pronounced, as explained, as written down in the Old Testament. The commandments of God are the Torah. One God, one Messiah, he fulfilled that. And so Jesus used the law and the prophets to push away Satan. He said, it is written. Where is it written? It is written. Where is it written? Where it is written. And it's all in the Old Testament. So who wants to keep you away from the law and the prophets? In all of creation, name me one person that wants to keep you away from God's law and God's prophets. Name me one person in all creation that wants to do that. Amen. Exactly. So ask yourself, who's trying to draw you closer to actually the law and the prophets? Jesus. Because if you wouldn't have had Jesus, you would have never had the law and the prophets. It's the gospel that came out and brought you and united you to Israel, God's chosen people, Jesus. Jesus was sent out to you to bring you to the law and the prophets. Jesus brings you back to the law and the prophets because he fulfilled it. It's only Satan. It's only Satan that takes you away from the law and the prophets, which is the word of God. Jesus used the law and the prophets to defy, to resist, and to overcome Satan. Period. The law and the prophets are Jesus's, and I'm Jesus's, because he loved me before I loved him. And he died for me and paid the price for my redemption.
Amen.
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 You can't argue with Jesus Christ. He said, if you love me, you confess with your mouth that you love me, then keep my commandments. Jesus said, by their works, you will know them. By their works. It's not their confession, it's not their prayers, it's anything. It's their works. What are they doing? See what they're doing. And what are they doing? Are they going to brothels? Is that legal, permissible by God? No. Why? Because it says that in the Bible. They're eating pork. Is that permissible by God? No. How do you know that, Victor? Because Leviticus chapter 11 says that's an abomination to God. You guys quote Isaiah 53. And you guys want to slap people with Isaiah 53. Okay, slap me with Isaiah 53. I take it gracefully with love and mercy. That points to my Messiah. You guys are forgetting Isaiah 56. That talks about the Sabbath. Read it up. Isaiah 56. It talks about the Sabbath. Same God, same prophet, same words. You guys don't want to quote that. Okay? How about Isaiah 66, the very last chapter in Isaiah? That talks about eating pork and the abomination and eating rats. Oh, okay. So now we understand. Isaiah 50. Okay, you guys wanna hold on to Isaiah 53. You guys are gonna go teach the Jews about Isaiah 53, but you guys don't want to teach about things that convict you. You guys are liars and hypocrites and Pharisees. Or you're just the least of the kingdom of God, that's your pursuit. That's your choice too. God has bad choices. Bad choices, my friends. You're gonna say, wow, you know what? God is holy and God is right, and God's words are eternal and true, and they are never changing. God never changes. You're working with a living God, my friends. So I stand in humility. I'm here because of the grace and mercy of God. Not because I fulfilled anything. Okay, so here's another thing. How much time do I have?
A minute and a half.
Galatians talks about this. You cannot be justified before God if you do not have Jesus, period. Righteousness comes up by faith, which leads according to the law of God. You cannot teach the commandments of God and people's own righteousness without Jesus. Even if you did try to fulfill all the commandments of God, starting to this day, it's going to be worthless because you're born in sin. Your righteousness is nothing. When it first comes to Jesus Christ, Galatians is talking about priorities. It's talking about priorities. Is the law the priority, or is the faith in Jesus Christ the priority? That's the question. The Pharisees wanted the law because they could convert and pervert the law and contort the words with wise speech and things like that. But when you have faith in Jesus Christ, you rebuke that Satan in Jesus' name.
Amen.
First is faith, priority. Galatians talks about priority. Faith in Jesus first. The law will follow. Righteousness will follow. But your faith is first. Your faith is in Jesus Christ. Your faith is in Jesus Christ. A righteous man falls seven times and gets up. Faith. Righteousness is... faith is righteousness. The just shall live by faith. Your faith is that Jesus is right.
that we're wrong and Jesus is right.
10 seconds.
In Jesus' name, Jesus, you're right. Lord God, every man is a liar, but you're right. Lord God, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is heaven. In Jesus' name, amen.
And John, thanks for not making me cut you off in the middle of prayer. Thank you. All right, so closing statement from Brother Andy, and your time starts now.
Okay, well, again, thank you know for only to be here, but you know, just as you know, there were some strong words that he said there in his last closing statements, but I want to tell you the strong words that the Apostle Paul had for those who hold the view that Victor has. And he says, because again, I want to establish again, you know, we kind of spent a lot of time on Acts 15 and 1 John a bit. And you know, right now, you know, he brought up a lot of passages, and I can try to get to as many as possible, but I think it's still important to notice. Well, first, he didn't address Colossians chapter 2 that I brought up in my first actual rebuttal statement, I think, or my opening statement about Paul telling the Colossians, let no one judge you in food or in drink or in regards to feasts or Sabbath days or and Sabbaths and things. For those things are shadow things to come, but the substance is of Christ. No response there. Second, Romans 14, he actually suggested that it was it could have been about culture. It wasn't about culture. It's pretty clear if you read Romans chapter 14. When it speaks about meats, it's actually speaking about food. And that's why he made the distinction between food and vegetables. You know, meats and vegetables. So meats is just as like in the Old Testament when it says that God made every herb bearing seed, you know, for meats. Well, herb is not a meat. It's another word. It's another way of saying food. So the issue there was it was not about culture. It was about exactly what it says, that there were days, including Sabbath days and other feast days, that some would keep and some would not. And Paul is saying, hey, be convinced in your own mind about it, because if you observe the Sabbath or the Feast of Tabernacles or any other days, feast days, if you observe it to the Lord, you observe it. That's according to your faith. If you don't observe the Sabbath or the Feast of Tabernacles or any other feast days, to the Lord, you do not observe it. So it's not about culture, my friends. It's about faith. And he ends that whole chapter by saying, whatever is not of faith, it is sin. So just to establish that. Now, the Apostle Paul, in I want to bring you very quickly, because again, circumcision was part of the law of God. Sabbath, the unclean foods, and many other things. And in Philippians chapter 3, Paul writes this, some very harsh words. And remember, he's referring to them that believe. They're Pharisees that believe on Christ. It's the same situation here. My brother Victor believes on Christ. He believes in Christ. I don't doubt it. But he has the same problem that the Pharisees had. That after believing in Christ, that if they don't keep the law of Moses and be circumcised, you cannot be saved. I've heard Victor a lot of times now confidently to say that, and you guys heard yourselves, that there's, he says there's one law, you know, one God, which yes, there is one God, but after we believe on Christ, if we don't keep the law of Moses, as he's suggesting for us to do when it comes to, you know, circumcision, the foods and the feast days and all these things, if we don't keep those things, that means we're sinning against God. And where does sin leads, my friends?
Damnation.
It leads to damnation. So this is about salvation. And so it's hard to actually understand what he's trying to promote, because it seems like he's trying to say that the Pharisees there had something different than what he does, but there is none. They believed, but they wanted the Gentiles to keep the law of Moses. Victor is promoting the same thing here tonight. He wants you to keep the law of Moses, because if you don't, you're sinning against God. It's that simple. And then in Philippians chapter 3, Paul says this about the circumcision. And remember, it's not circumcision of those not, but those that believe, not unbelievers. Said, finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord, for me to write the same things to you is not tedious, but for you it is safe. Beware of dogs. Beware of the mutilation. Mutilation, you know what that speaks to? That speaks to the circumcision. Because obviously in circumcision, you are mutilating part of your body, for males, that is. And then he justifies those that are in the spirit who do not go back, as just as it was the problem with the Galatians. The Galatians, I don't know why he's quoting Galatians when Galatians is refuting the very position that you have. But in Philippians chapter 3, it says, for we are the circumcision who worship God in the spirit, who rejoice in Jesus, in Christ Jesus, and have no confidence in the flesh, though I also might have confidence in the flesh. So, and it says, if anyone else thinks he may have confidence in the flesh, I more so. Circumcised the eighth day, of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, Hebrew of Hebrews, concerning the law, a Pharisee, concerning zeal, persecuting the church, concerning righteousness, which is of the law, blameless. But what things were gained to me, these I have counted loss for Christ. He counted all those things, circumcision, feast days, Sabbath, everything that he learned in the law and the actual traditions of the elders, he called them rubbish, dumb, just that he might know the substance, which is Christ. And obviously, to believe in Christ, obviously, is not to be lawless. Christians are not lawless. But again, the law of Moses is the former covenant. Now we're under a new covenant. They're not the same thing. And in Galatians, the Apostle Paul is rebuking the Galatians harshly. You know, who's bewitched you? You know, and things of that nature. They were deceived. How? They believed in Christ. They received the Spirit of God through faith in Christ. But then what happened? They wanted doing the very thing that Victor is telling us to do, to go back to the law. What was those things that were part of the law? Circumcision. And what did Paul say to them? Now, after being made perfect in the spirit, or being justified in the spirit, are you truly made perfect by the flesh? By the flesh? Circumcision? You see, it's not wrong to keep the Sabbath, you know, after we believe on Christ. It's not wrong to keep feast days. They have prophetic meaning. But the thing is that it doesn't justify you. Just because you keep the Sabbath or keep the Feast of Tabernacles or any other feast, it doesn't mean that you're right before God. You can keep the feasts and you can keep those feasts, but it will mean nothing. It will mean nothing, because those things don't justify you. And if you don't keep it, you're not sinning against God either. Why? Because that's not part of the new covenant. But I realize that there are Christians who keep the feasts and Sabbath, and that's fine. According to what Romans 14 says, they keep it by faith unto the Lord, because they do that unto the Lord, amen, according to their faith. But those that don't, Victor is telling us that you're sinning against God. So basically, we know that most Christians don't keep the Sabbath day. Most Christians don't wear the actual fringes. Most Christians don't keep feast days. So basically, most Christians are basically, either going to hell or, as he said, maybe be least in the kingdom. But it's interesting, John the Baptist, we know he comes from a line of priests, being a prophet. We know he kept the law. you know, even though he does meet Christ like everyone else. But Jesus said about John the Baptist, there's no greater man that's been born of women except John the Baptist. But yet Jesus said, he who was least in the kingdom of God is greater than he. Think about that.
About time. All right, so that ends the general session of the debate. We are going to enter into a quick section. We've got a limited amount of time, but we're going to take a couple questions from the audience. And I guess with respect to the answers and questions, we'll keep 1 minute to a response from both parties. You guys are okay with that?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, definitely.
All right, so Lubella, you have a question.
So in the book of John, Jesus performed a miracle and the crippled man next to the pool, right? But that was on the day of the Sabbath.
Correct.
So how does that work out?
Who's the question for? For both?
Yeah.
Okay, so 1 minute, 1 minute, 10.
Sure.
Okay, starts now.
Okay, so the question is this. Where is it in the law that says you cannot heal on the Sabbath? There isn't. Actually, even Jesus says, look at, it's somewhere in the New Testament, I can't, it says that if you see a donkey that's over there, like perishing or whatever, it fell on the Sabbath, don't you go and pick it up? You know, if you see your neighbor's donkey, like in travail, if it's in pain, don't you go and pick it up on the Sabbath? Don't you go water your donkey on the Sabbath? So the problem is that the Pharisees don't know what law they're breaking or abiding by, because they have their own laws. And so he did not break the law, he did not break the commandment by healing. The Pharisees actually had no respect for Jesus. They just didn't have respect for Jesus Christ. They did not believe in him. That's why he rebuked them to his face, and he said, in your sin you shall die. He never broke the commandments of God, because it's not law. Yeah.
And Andy?
It was obviously not forbidden to heal on the Sabbath. The Pharisees, they because of a lot of traditions that they had, they accused Jesus of sinning by him healing on the Sabbath. But it was just a gross misunderstanding on the part of the Pharisees because of their traditions. Jesus said that they nullified the word of God for their traditions. So they thought that Jesus was sinning against God by, healing on the Sabbath. But Jesus said, Victor pointed, rightly out, if you have a donkey that falls in a ditch on the Sabbath, are you not going to pick it up on the Sabbath? So therefore, human beings, if they're sick on the Sabbath, don't they heal?
Really quick, we have an agreement on that.
Yes. So he never broke the Sabbath.
Okay. And just out of respect for time, does anybody have another question?
Yeah.
What's your name, sir?
Marcos.
Marco, and it's for who? Question
for Victor.
Victor.
So you're saying we should keep the 613 laws. There was laws in there concerning slavery. Like, they were allowed to buy male and female slaves. So are you saying we should go by those laws? And there was another law. And I'm just picking out certain laws that are not being, like, you're
trying to keep it one question.
Yeah, all right. Now, it's related to the same thing. So there was another law concerning childbirth. So a woman that gave birth to a male was unclean for 7 days. And if she did not circumcise him or bring a lamb offering, that's it. We're saying you're going to hell or you're not keeping the law. Like, if your mother didn't do that, is that what's going to happen, or are you going to hell?
Okay. So we're
for Is that a fair question?
Okay. 1 John 3:4, whosoever commits sin transgresses also the law, for the sin is the transgression of the law. What I'm telling you is that when it turns into in respect of slavery, there's rules and regulations for slavery. Absolutely. What Americans did here was not according to the rules and regulations here. That was an abomination. Slavery in the United States was not the slavery that is controlled and regulated by God. Those are rules and regulations for the safety and respect of the slave. Okay? When it comes to being hallowed and unclean, absolutely. There's laws for cleanliness and purity. And even in sexual conduct, there's rules and regulation. Cleanliness, what's defilement, what's righteous and pure. Yes.
because God did not give you something to defile yourself, but in fact, the contrary, that's what he gives you. Look at, there's other cultures that are doing this, don't do that, don't learn from them. They're pagans, they're nasty, they're gross, they're defiled, do this instead. And so that's what I stand for.
Amen.
Amen.
I would agree that, you know, obviously with the slavery that happened here in the U.S. is not according to the slavery that was that we see in the actual Old Testament. But it's a bit troubling, though, that I just heard that the question was that if a woman gave birth and the firstborn, you know, they had to offer the woman had to go to the temple and offer a sacrifice, you know, for her ritual cleansing. Now, what I just heard was that, you know, that we should be doing this today too. You know, you can correct that if I'm wrong in the next, you know, answer thing. But then that means every woman that given childbirth is under sin, because there is no temple to go to and no one's sacrificing things so that they can be ritually impure. So I don't know.
Jason, do you have a question?
Yes.
Who's it for?
Victor.
Yes.
I just want to thank God for this moment of time, all of us gathered, conversing. But you say that Christ came to fulfill the law. And why did he neglect the law, the statute of God, stated in Leviticus 20:10 about, and the man that committeth adultery with another man's wife, even he that committeth adultery with his neighbor's wife, the adulterer and the adulteress shall surely be put to death.
All right, time starts now.
Okay, so the question is this, is there mercy in law? Is there mercy? Where's mercy? Because honestly, from our first transgression, we should be put to death. From our first transgression. First of all, there's supposed to be two people put to death. There's only one that was brought to judgment. And Jesus is merciful. He's a merciful judge. And Jesus said himself, don't judge, because the way you judge, you'll be judged. And so since Jesus was judging her, he said, look, I judge you not either, so sin no more. So first of all, it's not a correct judgment. He did not neglect it. He fulfilled it. And so don't take that heresy out of you. Say, look, no, only Jesus is right. He fulfilled every single commandment. It's my misunderstanding for me to think that Jesus didn't fulfill the law. And that was God's judgment. His covenant, his mercy. His mercy for this woman. But he also gave a commandment. He also told her, look, I don't judge you. I'm not going to kill you right now. But he also said, go and sin no more. We also know that any transgression of the law is sin. But he said, don't sin anymore.
Do you want to respond?
Obviously, you know, the law came through Moses, but first John chapter 1 says grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. So it's a good question actually in this context, because, you know, stoning was part of the law, but yes, you know, we've all sinned. So like, if we stone somebody else, basically we should be stoned too, because we've sinned as well. But even after people get converted, we could use the apostles as an example. You know, they went around preaching the gospel, and there was many homosexuals and other people committing adultery and things, but they didn't go around stoning people, even though they were forgiven by Christ, so they were sanctified and made holy. But they didn't go around stoning people. That's because we're under the new covenant. So.
And we have time for one more question. I did see one hand in the back. So we can ask questions afterwards.
What?
To somebody. Yeah. Stephen, we can ask afterwards. Okay. Stephen, what's your question and who's it to?
The question is for Victor. And the question is, what do you make of Galatians chapter 5, verses 1 to 14, where it says, stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Behold, I, Paul, say unto you that if ye be circumcised, Christ shall profit you nothing. For I testify again to every man that is circumcised that he is a debtor to do the whole law. Christ has become of no effect unto you. Whosoever you are justified by the law, you are fallen from grace. For we through the Spirit wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. For in Jesus Christ neither circumcision availeth anything nor uncircumcision, but faith which worketh by love. You did run well. Who did hinder you that you should not obey the truth? this persuasion cometh not of him that calleth you. A little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. I have confidence in you through the Lord that you will be none otherwise minded, but he that troubleth you shall bear his judgment, whosoever he be. And I, brethren, if I yet preach circumcision, why do I yet suffer persecution? Then is the offense of the cross ceased? I would that they were even cut off which trouble you. For brethren, you have been called unto liberty. Only use not your liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even in this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. What does your entire argument make of that passage?
This is the subject of that passage. Justification. Do you understand that? Who's justifying you?
Jesus.
Jesus. Period. Read it again. That's all I have to say.
Okay. Do you want to respond?
Well, obviously that's a real nail in the coffin, really, because that passage that this brother read basically brings almost to a summation what us Christians, you know, how we ought to see, you know, the actual law, you know, even after we come to faith in Christ. And obviously the Galatians were believers, but again, as I was saying earlier, you know, and as is clear in the book of Galatians, Paul was rebuking them, correcting them harshly for them going back to the law. Know, which includes the circumcision and all these things. So yes, it's about justification, but if you're sinning against God by not keeping those, that has to be justification.
All right, that ends tonight's debate. I just want to thank Brother Victor for coming, sir.
Thank you for having
Brother
me. Andy, God bless you,
of course.
Jesus loves us and he died for us. We're both sinners, my friends. We're both sinners.
No, we're saints, man.
We were sinners, but now we're saints. Through the blood of Jesus Christ, our faith, and the testimony of God. And the remnant shall be saved.
And
the remnant is who? Keep the testimony of Jesus Christ and the commandments of God as described in Revelation.
And
the remnant shall be saved.
Amen. So we're just going to end in a quick prayer. Father God, we just thank you for bringing everybody together, Lord. We thank you for these two servants of God. We just ask that your Holy Spirit continue to give us wisdom, knowledge, and understanding of the scriptures, Lord. Let it not be of our own understanding, but let it be, come from the Spirit of truth, which is your Holy Spirit, Lord. We just thank you for this night. We thank you for what you've given us. We just hope that it was edifying to the church. We hope that it was edifying to the saints, Lord, and let everybody learn from it, Lord, what you want us to learn. And let it glorify you, let it glorify your Son, in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
God bless you guys. We got to go.
God
bless you.
I got to stop.
All right. Amen.
Amen. God bless you.
No, that's okay.
We got the picture, though.
We can't.
Yeah,
oh, cheers. We're on a time limit.